Thank you all for coming here tonight. I'm going to recite an essay that I've been working on and should give you a little idea of where I've come from and where I'm going and maybe a few plans for the future. So, raise your hand if you've ever been asked that simple, inevitable question, what do you want to be when you grow up? Yeah, a lot of you. Some of you probably took the matter very seriously, returning a thoughtful answer. Others probably laughed it off. It's really an intensely personal question, kind of like asking who you dream of marrying someday. Personally, I'm one of those thoughtful types who tries to calculate salary, location, and opportunity for advancement into my practical dream job. When I was little, I knew exactly what I wanted to be when I grew up. I wanted to be a historical figure. Someone from the age of knights and fair maidens, or at the very least, the age of hoopskirts. Unfortunately, I was thwarted in these dreams very early on, so I had to resort to the only alternative, books. I can't tell you how many books I read about the Tudor dynasty of England, or the much maligned person of Richard III, or the tragic Joan of Arc, or the Romanovs of old Russia. I spent years living in their worlds, studying their lives, and generally obsessing about them. But since a career in medieval Europe was less than probable, I needed a plan B. For a long time, I thought I could make a living writing the kind of historical fiction novels I was always gobbling up, but I nixed that one after hearing one too many starving author stories. I thought perhaps I could be a museum curator, or one of those enthusiastic reenactors who dresses up in period clothing and regales you with the fascinating history of butter churns. But I was startled one evening when my parents sat me down and asked the inevitable question. I still didn't have a concrete idea about a future job, but surprisingly, my mom did. Out of the blue, she said, "I've always pictured you as a teacher." That was a shocker. I didn't really see myself as teacher material. Did I really want to spend the rest of my life wiping the noses of snotty-nosed kids and teaching evolution to high schoolers? But then I began to remember times long ago when I would play school with my little brother and try to teach him his first grade lessons. I probably owe Aaron an apology for that one. I think I took it a bit too far sometimes. But I came to realize that I really do love information, and I love to share it with others. So though I wasn't sure at first, the idea of being a teacher began to grow on me. To be certain that teaching was my true calling, I turned to the infallible personality test. 20 pounds of library books later, I narrowed the field to something between cartoonist and accountant. And I decided that a teaching position might be in the realm of possibility. However, there was one hitch in my dream of being a teacher. I have been homeschooled my entire life and have never attended a public or private school. If I was going to realistically pursue this career, I needed to see a school from the inside. My parents and I decided that job shadowing would be a great way to do this. I could get a good look at several different types of schools. To begin, I shadowed a friend of ours, Audrey Steele, in her kindergarten classroom. I spent the day helping Audrey by doing such grown-up, teacherly things as cutting out a paper hippopotamus and coloring him with crayons. I got to try real cafeteria food for the first time in my life. It might sound a little weird, but this was actually one of the highlights of my day. I really liked working with the kids. Some of them were frustrating, but altogether they were so sweet and funny and affectionate that it was hard not to love them. The day ended with a sweet, old-fashioned read aloud and one of the children vomiting on another kid's backpack. I truly enjoyed my first day of kindergarten, but something told me I wasn't cut out to be an elementary teacher. Next, I shadowed Miss Griffin, a history teacher at a public high school, and was able to study the younger generation in their natural habitat. Many of them seemed like normal, likable teens, though a few had disturbing fashion sense.